Next up, we have Phil Baines. From the Motor Car Act to Motorways, British Road Signs from 1903 to 1958. Phil, I first met Phil at Type 90 in Oxford, which was my first day at Type I conference. It's interesting to come full circle here. Back to Britain. Yes? Can't hear? Okay. Then we're all going to have to bend down, or you're going to have to increase the volume on this. Yes? Phil Baines is fairly well known to all of you, I imagine. He and Catherine Dixon have done walking tours at A-Type I conferences for quite a while, and we'll be doing another one on Sunday, walking tour of Brighton, after the end of the conference proper. Phil is a freelance designer, professor of typography at the University of the Arts, London, Central St. Martin's. It seems sometimes as though the name of that institution gets longer every time I read it. He's worked with Catherine Dixon on book designs for Fiden Press, Lawrence King, and for the award-winning Penguin Books Great Ideas series. They're frequent contributors to I, again, as many of you are probably quite familiar with reading. Other writing includes the website publiclettering.org.uk and the book Signs, Lettering and the Environment. He's written two other books, Type and Typography, with Andrew Haslam, who's also here, second edition 2005. And Penguin by Design, a cover story, 1935 to 2005. Not surprisingly, published by Penguin. And I turn it over to Phil.
Thank you. The road signs currently in use in Britain have been developed from those introduced in the early 1960s following the Anderson Report on motorway signs and the War Boys Report on traffic signs for all-purpose roads. This period piece here shows full-size sign test by the Ministry of Transport in October 1962. Today I'm concerned with what preceded these signs, and the chronology I'm going to describe is correct, but the more I find out about it, the more little detailed gaps I find there are in most of the accounts, and there are still some bits of digging I need to do. Before the motor car, and since the introduction of turnpike roads in the mid to late 17th century, such signs as there were on Britain's roads tended to be of the milestone variety, and this is one of the very fine Trinity Hall series that runs south of Cambridge to Barkway. In the mid-19th century, however, roads were in decline, largely due to the impact of railway travel, and Parliament had to bail out the privately owned turnpike companies in 1876. Before the Road Traffic Act of 1930, the authority for erecting direction posts came from Section 24 of the Highways Act 1835, and for erecting warning signs from Section 10 of the Motor Car Act of 1903. There are many older people who remember the pre-War Boys signs fondly, and view War Boys as being an early example of the British government acquiescing to European standards. But the 1903 Motor Car Act acknowledges the need for international agreement on signs, and this discussion about the international nature of them is a feature of every British report, memorandum, and statutory legislation since. The following year, local government sent a circular to all the authorities about the proposal to adopt certain uniform symbols for signs described in the Act. Speed limits would have a white 18-inch ring with a plate underneath containing the maximum. Prohibition signs would be indicated by a red 18-inch disc, not normally mounted on a drainpipe, but you get the idea. Caution would be indicated by a hollow red triangle with 18-inch sides. and all other signs would be on diamond-shaped boards. All of these had to be sighted 8 feet above the ground and 50 yards before the location referred to. And the sort of get-out clause is that they recommended that no legislation would be passed or should be passed if the recommendations were carried out. From 1906, the Automobile Association began introducing its yellow discs. And 2 years later, the RAC was signing Watling Street and the Motor Union, the London to Dover and Folkestone roads. And initially, the motoring organisations were there really to protect and defend the motorists' rights against the sort of the police force, basically. The Department of Transport wasn't created until 1919. The First World War had caused great improvements in automobiles generally, but in larger vehicles in particular. And really there was then a very urgent need to attend to roads in quite a different way than had been done before the war. Sir Alec Campbell Geddes was Director General of Roads, and among the first acts of the department was to oversee the introduction of road numbering, rather like the French model. And André Michelin also acted in an unofficial capacity in advising perhaps a system for doing this. England and Wales were divided into 6 segments defined by the principal roads A1, A2, etc., and these radiate clockwise from London. Scotland was divided into 3, A7 to 9, radiating from Edinburgh. As regards to signing, legislation was still not tackled. The department continued to act through instructions. Campbell Geddes issued a memorandum on road signs and direction posts in 1920, and this covered road direction posts, warning signs and notices, and village and place names. And these recommendations became part of Circular 39, open brackets, roads, close brackets, issued on the 28th of February 1921. In the National Archives is a watercolour sketch from Geddes' memorandum working out how the new direction posts, the village signs and the warning signs should look. For road direction posts, there are comprehensive written guidelines to ensure standardisation. So the height of the height of the arm from the ground had to be a minimum of 8 feet, maximum of 9. Length of arm, including root number, minimum 3'6". Depth of arm, minimum 7 inches, etc. There's also a little mistake on this sign. Right over on the left, the root number is incorporated. For an A road, it should be black on white. And for a B road, white out of black. In fact, here it repeats an A number. And then it's crossed out and there's a little B written above. We'll come back to that in a minute. For lettering, there was absolutely no specification as to the particular model to be followed. Presumably, the assumption being that every foundry in the country possessed pattern letters which would do the job perfectly well. So street names would be a typical example of contemporary practice, and this is from 1907. And it's certainly before 1917 when postcode numbers come in. All the memorandum specifies is that lettering has to be raised block letter on a white ground, a single line, 3-inch letters, 2 lines, 2.5-inch letters, and 1/2-inch space between the lines. And as I've said, the new route numbers should be incorporated. 4-inch raised block letters, black on white for A roads, white out of black for B roads. We do have C roads, but they're never acknowledged on signs, or very seldom. The posts had to be white, and they recommended that the highway authority responsible should be indicated on them. What this resulted in was a wonderful variety of signs made by a wide variety of manufacturers, which more or less met the requirements of the memorandum. So here's an example in London. But there's great variety. So a typical Sussex sign is made of wood with metal letters screwed to it. Or you might have a combination of cast iron posts, wooden boards, again cast iron letters screwed. Here we're in the Ashdown Forest, indicated by that sort of logo on the top. Most of the posts have a maker's mark on them. Some of the biggest companies were Stanton's of Ilkeston or the Royal Label Factory from Stratford-upon-Avon. And you get some quite funny ones. In Cornwall, a lot of the sort of roads are lined with sort of turf walls, and gradually, the undergrowth has just engulfed the sign. So there's about 7 foot of turf, and then you get the sign. And then some saddo like me comes along and clears away so they can take a photograph. Some of them in Cornwall have, so this next little set is all from Cornwall, these sort of anti-bird spikes on the top. Or maybe it's a sort of anti-vandal kind of thing. Another maker's mark. So this is Bissick's from Devoren near Falmouth. So many of these are actually very local. So in Cornwall you find examples from Bissick's and also the Charleston Foundry. And others, as I say, were much, much bigger companies who produced signs for use all over the country. This is the most complex example that I know about, or that's been reproduced in books. And this one is preserved now in a little museum in Devon called Dingles, which there'll be more pictures from there later. But that's, quite nutty, really. Another local variety, these wooden ones in the Bodmin area. And on the top of these, wooden posts, clamped on with iron straps. And unusually upper and lower case, quite non-regulation. And they're not really as helpful as they might be. I mean, this one looks very good. You get the idea there are four roads meeting here. Well, they're not quite. Because there's four roads, but two of them are some distance down the lane. So if you're coming from the opposite direction, you're buggered, basically. And occasionally you get things like this where there's just no post. So this is quite a lot of them preserved at Dingles. So you see some of the variety there. There is a variety of ages here. Which we'll come to. But basically these, although they start in 1921, they are an allowable piece of the legislation right up until 1964. And if you can just see that bottom one, there has been a bit of talk about maths fonts and stuff on A-Type-I recently. I would like to see a few more fractions like this, please. So they're very lovely. And as I say, the local authority was supposed to be indicated. So a typical way of doing that was to have a ring at the top. And again, Dingles has one from every old county. One of the other sections then of the memorandum concerned warning signs and notices. And so this is from Geddy's notes again. You can't really tell in these photographs here, but the mistake in his visual about the A and B road is repeated in the full-size mock-up they made and photographed. And that mistake is then repeated. Sorry, there's the warning sign. So that's how they looked. But the mistake is repeated in one of these official things as well. Village signs and place names, as I say, were also part of the memorandum, and the photograph of one of those I've got is on a lightbox in London, I'm afraid. But some of those still survive in Norfolk. There is little significant change in practice for the next few years. Internationally, there are conventions in Paris in 1926, April 1930. There's a League of Nations report of the Permanent Committee on Road Traffic regarding road signalling in Geneva, 1928. And in Britain, another memorandum, number 291, but these did little beyond confirm the status quo. In 1929, under the chairmanship of Arthur Griffith Boscawen, there's a first report, The Control of Traffic on Roads, but that concentrated on the free movement and control of traffic and safety. There's a first reference to roundabouts in paragraph 12, and it explains the introduction of traffic lights in Wolverhampton in paragraph 36. There are proposals for a driving test and draft proposals for a code of custom for all road users. This would eventually appear as the Highway Code and appear in print in 1931 with this exciting cover. On road signs, it acknowledged their usefulness but deplores their lack of uniformity. And then there's a paragraph which then seems to appear in every subsequent memorandum, circular or report on traffic signs in this country ever since. It's most important that the road signs which are erected should be uniform in design and intention and should be no more numerous than are actually required. This has appeared in every single report that the country has ever produced, and it's been ignored ever since. Now, I'm only familiar with one other country's sort of road signs contemporary with the things I'll show you. I'm showing you, and so there's a brief excursion into France now. The earliest French examples I've seen are made of cast iron, simply screwed fairly high up onto the sides of buildings, and then the Michelin brothers get involved. They take a very early interest in the road infrastructure and do far more than just make tyres. They're quickly producing their own version in glazed ceramic on concrete. So the early ones are the plaques like this. And then through the 1920s, they work on their most distinctive signs, the Born Michelin. And they get introduced in 1928. And they look like this. An account in Arts et Métiers Graphiques Paris from 1931 confidently says they are sun, rain, hail and frost resistant and don't fear the stones of the vandals and the bullets of the hunters. These are made of concrete. So these are 1.75 metres high. They weigh 380 kilograms. The information panel is glazed ceramic on 15mm rock from the Volvic region, and then that's placed on the concrete in huge moulds. They are all signed on the bottom corner with the date and the location of their sighting. And I've really annoyed my family on quite a lot of French holidays by stopping at every single one I've seen, bar one, and photographing them. They also made two-dimensional versions, but I've only ever seen one of these. And they continued to make signs for the French roads from these materials until 1970. But from 1946, the design had to match the new national standards. But on the back of each of these, cast in the concrete, is a little picture of Bibendum and again the year, which is sometimes different from the year that's signed on the panel itself. Back in Britain, Common practice was generally regarded as satisfactory, but the need was felt for actual statutory legislation. So we set up a committee. It looked at everything, and its findings were published as the report of the Departmental Committee on Traffic Signs, 1933, generally referred to as the Maybury Report, after its chairman. The committee takes a good look at everything, and they try and balance practicality, existing practice, with a certain amount of forward thinking, I suppose. So when it comes to the warning signs, they actually allow them to continue as before, because it notes they are a permitted variant of the 1926 convention, that's the international one, but it notes that words help the symbols, and their use in this country was established, and therefore it should continue. It also notes that more should be added or may be needed in the future. On prohibition signs, it again notes that the European Conference of 1931 adopted the red disc, which we'd used since 1920, and its continued use was recommended. Mandatory signs, keep left, one way, etc., should be blue, surmounted by a red ring. And informatory signs, such as parking signs, made square in accordance with the 1931 International Convention. Odd signs, or very specific signs, are allowed to be different sizes or different shapes, such as the halt and the slow. So there's some more from Ingalls. They note that there are great difficulties with overcrowding of information on finger posts, and there are problems with the size and location of them, and that some advanced word-based direction signs have been tried. So this is a very battered example from Dingle's. But this is the first time that in this country there is the concept that you might need a sign before the actual junction. So all the finger posts exist at the junction itself. And today when you find them, they tend to be on minor roads, so that's not a massive problem. But as roads began to improve in the 1930s and we start to build the sort of the big arterial roads, the Western Avenue and so on, you need a different kind of signing. So this report acknowledges that, and you have signs like this which tell you what's going to happen before it actually happens. They also make much more of route numbers, so they get priority. You work really from the route numbers first, and the destinations are secondary. Provision was also made for other organisations to produce their own signs in accordance with the regulations. So both the AA and the RAC produce signs in great quantities. The AAs tended not to conform to the ministry standards, which annoyed the ministry and it annoyed the RAC, but they seem somehow powerless to stop this. And for the first time in material from the ministry, there are this time specifications as to the lettering. A capitals-only alphabet in normal and condensed width was produced, shown in the report and described with pedantic verbal explanation. Here's another sign, this time an RAC sign. So they are fairly clear, and you know, for 1933 they're quite forward looking, I think. The alphabet is described later as based on advice from Hubert Llewellyn Smith. He was the chair of the Institute of Industrial Arts, among other things, and Mr. J.G. West, a senior architect of HM Office of Works. Anthony Froschau, writing in 1963, mentions Edward Johnson's involvement, and it would be understandable, given his long experience of working on the the fonts for the Underground Group and then London Transport. But so far I've found no actual evidence to support this. The signs set out by Mabry confirm the earlier 1921 models and continue as the basis for all road signs until the end of the period under discussion, with a number of adaptations. In 1944, as victory in the war was certain and planning for reconstruction began in earnest again, another committee was set up to review traffic signs. Known as the Cook Report, this made all the sizes and detailing of signs far more explicit than Mabry, and there's much clearer annotated diagrams. But for most signs, there are generally no changes to the sizes, just small amendments to make, small amendments. On colours, on diagrams, the lettering now had to be black on white, and reflective 7/8-inch diameter studs could be added to improve the nocturnal visibility on signs. And the posts supporting the signs could now have alternate bands of black and white at 1 foot intervals. This had been suggested in 1930 in a circular, but was not actually part of the Mabry 1933 report. The stripes were also applied to the posts of warning signs. And I believe Andy Altman has also been bidding for these on eBay recently. The most prominent amendment by Cook was the introduction of coloured panels on direction signs. For added conspicuity in towns, and after discussion with the Fine Arts Commission, they recommend the use of light chrome from British Standard No. 381, 1930, a colour similar to my shirt, but as far as I can find out, no longer available. So yellow is used as the backing for signs on through routes. These next few are strictly speaking a little later than 1944, but we'll come back to that. So the previous one was the advance warning sign, and then here is the route confirmation sign. For local approach signs, these should not have more than three panels, and the background panels should be traffic blue in urban areas, such as this from Rye. And these examples still surviving in London. And in the country, they should be black. The Cook Report comes at a slightly awkward time. It confirms existing practice, but it comes a couple of years before the Geneva Convention on Road Traffic Signs from 1948, which resulted in the protocol and the adoption by most European and many other countries of a much more standardised set of symbolic signs, largely without words. What happens in Britain is that there is continual sort of tweaking of the system. Little things get tested. In Slough in the 1950s, they tested road markings, different carriageway alignments, how to amend map and stack type signs. And some of these things get added to the 1957 traffic signs, size, colour and type regulations and general directions. There is a copy of this in the Ministry of Transport, dated 1955, and it is so riddled with proof marks, it's clear that it needed another 2 years of work on it. The Highway Code of that year, included all the revisions. Yes, I forgot about this. Michelin were continuing in making concrete signs as well to the Geneva Protocol design. So this is the last highway code before war, boys. And you can see how sort of disparate and disjointed perhaps the British system had become by this point. They've accepted for a long time that the 30 mile an hour speed limit should just say 30 in a white circle within a red circle. Why you can't apply the same logic to 40, I don't know. Why you have to explain that 40 is miles per hour and 30 is just 30. You know, there's all sorts of anomalies like this in there, and nobody seems to have batted an eyelid. The other slightly odd thing is that the highway code continues to be printed like this as late as 1966, 2 years after the introduction of the new road signs. And there you see the sort of advanced direction sign. And the checkered line across the middle means that if you take the left-hand road, it's the A6 to Loughborough, and along that road you will then come to the A514 to Ashby. We use brackets around route numbers to do the same job now. The only significant change really in 1957 was an amendment to the alphabet, which had many of its fussier details removed. The letters are shown in the report on tiles to guide the sign makers with spacing. And there is nothing about spacing in the 1933 or 1944 reports. It's just the alphabet. I think there's probably a lot more familiarity among the sign makers of those days in laying out letters. And if you think of wood type, there is no sort of lateral body to wood type, and it's largely spaced by eye. But by 1957, they realise that something needs to be done. Strangely, the new alphabet is shown alongside the old. It does not replace it. You may choose to use it, but that's as far as it goes. John Dreyfus, writing in the 1957 Penrose Annual about David Kindersley's street name alphabet, also mentions his work for the Ministry of Transport. Having been asked to look at the spacing and suggest improvements to their standard font, he insisted on being allowed to improve certain letters also. Now, it's not clear from what's reproduced in the Penrose Annual or from the actual report whether this final alphabet is Kindersley's alphabet or not, so I've got more digging to do at the Kindersley Archive in Cambridge and in the National Archives to get to the bottom of this. But what's clear to me, I think, is that this 57 alphabet is a massive improvement on the original Llewellyn Smith version. It's very clear, it's well spaced, it's a good all capitals signing letter. So the K just has a single junction. The G doesn't have a downward spur. It's much, much simpler. They also produced the revised alphabet as 3-inch cast aluminium letters, so you could update your 1921 style finger posts if you wanted. That was a 99p eBay find, three arms of a wooden finger post. But 1957, we have a situation where the motorways, which have been a twinkle in the ministry's eye for some years, since before the war in fact, are about to be built. In 1951, Sir Owen Williams and partners began work on surveying the route of the London to Yorkshire motorway, the first part of today's M1. Here it is shown on a 1961 map, ending at a roundabout near Crick, in the middle of nowhere. The Anderson Committee met to look at the motorway signs. This, as I said at the start, led to the War Boys Committee on Signs for the All-Purpose Roads. Taken together, these should have spelt the end of all the signs I've shown today, and that was certainly the intention. The War Boys report in section 302 mentions a 5-year plan of getting rid of everything. For in fact, there's been a number of different endings. So here's the men from the ministry on their test in 1962. Very few of the warning and prohibitory signs from pre-war boys exist. Dingles or exist on the roads. Dingles and other museums have collections, and they do crop up regularly on eBay. The direction signs of the 33, 44, 57 regulations should have all been replaced. And every couple of years, the department issues a new list to remind local authorities that they should be replaced. And in many areas, these seem to be forgotten about. Cat Hill in North London is probably the best known and the most complete junction I know of to survive. It's difficult to see how much longer. Most of the white has gone from the centre of these signs. And they're in generally a very bad condition. Personally, I'd quite like to see the whole roundabout restored to 1957 condition, but I can't quite see the department going with that. These signs are generally unloved, I would say, partly because the materials are not very seductive. They don't have the appeal of the older cast iron or wooden signs and so on. So these are generally ignored. However, there are websites such as Sabre and CBRD which show that road spotters are even nerdier than train spotters and are full of photographs and documents of where all this stuff exists. The finger posts from the 1921 to 33 period should also have been removed. Again, Dingles has a good collection of rescued examples. In fact, the situation around the country is very various, a bit like it is with the Bon Michelin in France. Some counties have fairly complete sets on all the minor roads. Cornwall is very good. Lincolnshire and parts of Norfolk are very good. Other counties just trash the lot immediately. They were given a reprieve in the 1994 regulations, and this allowed existing signs to remain as the roads on which most existed were minor and the signs are legible enough for the legal traffic speeds on that road, on those roads. Unfortunately, subsequent departmental advice also gives scope for councils to erect replica or lookalike versions on C roads. On most replicas, the detailing is generally poor, too neat and self-effacing. This isn't too bad, although it could do with black lining around the outsides and so on if it's going to fully replicate the original examples. The problem I have with the so-called lookalikes is that they're neither old-fashioned nor clearly contemporary. And in the departmental advice, it recommends that you have to use the transport alphabet, as that's the only officially prescribed alphabet for use on road signs. The transport alphabet was designed to be used in upper and lower case, apart from odd words like halt, stop, police, and so on. Used all capitals, it really isn't very good, and it's a little heavy. The fascist in me thinks that if a council got rid of all its finger posts in the 1960s, it really doesn't deserve them back. On a more positive note, counties such as Lincolnshire, Cornwall, Sussex, as I've said, have many, many fine survivors. In Somerset's Quantock Hills in 2004, a highway heritage project restored 30 examples, and a company in Llanwathby, Cumbria, also offers restoration services. Some stricter guidelines as to correct colours would be welcome. Thank you.